Everybody, this is Deborah Gasowitz with the National Sport Information Resource Center. We're very lucky to be housed here in Ottawa, so great opportunity for us. And we're thrilled to be doing this together, this webinar series together with the Ottawa Sport Council. Before we begin, I just want to go over a little bit of housekeeping for you to let you know that this webinar presentation is being recorded so that you will have it for future reference so that you can play it, you can share it with your team members, your board members, and other council members. The other thing is that throughout the webinar, you will see that there's an area on the bottom right-hand corner with the Q&As where you can type in your questions. Those will come to me, and then we'll have natural breaks throughout the presentation where I will be able to share those together with Kim. So the Q&A box on the bottom right-hand side is where you can enter your questions. There will be polling throughout it, and that's a chance for us to interact back and forth. So great opportunity to share the information. I know that we've got some great information coming. And so at this point, I'm very pleased to introduce Marcy Morris, the Executive Director of the Ottawa Sport Council, as she is going to bring us up to speed and tell us all about the presentation. So with that, Marcy, over to you.
Thanks so much, Deborah. First of all, I'd like to take the opportunity to thank everyone who's participating for joining us today. This is the first webinar in our winter and spring series of four webinars. We will be running a follow-on webinar series in the fall timeframe as well, and we're absolutely delighted to be able to be working with the Sport Information Resource Center on delivering these webinars to you. Before I turn things over to Kim, I want to take a couple of minutes to give you a bit of background about the Ottawa Sport Council. For those of you who aren't aware, we are a nonprofit membership-based service organization. We established ourselves in about 2013, and that was in response to a demand for assistance from community sporting organizations in Ottawa. We've taken on a number of key activities, but the three things that we've been doing predominantly over the last 2 years are working in conjunction with the City of Ottawa on the creation of a municipal sports strategy. The goal of this sports strategy is it's kind of the roadmap for the City of Ottawa in the next 5 years, and it includes things such as different spaces to play like fields, arenas, pools, ball diamonds. Also includes how sport volunteers are recognized, are acknowledged, are helped, are assisted within sport within the City of Ottawa. It also looks at things like how to make sport more open and accessible to everybody that's within the city. And finally, looks at things like sport tourism, what sort of events should we be bringing to Ottawa. The second thing we've been doing is supporting community sport organizations. We really want to help community sporting organizations build their organizational capacity and assist them with the challenges that they have. And the following thing we've been doing is trying to establish a common vision and a cohesive approach to sport that we can help sporting organizations talk to the City of Ottawa about what their challenges are and what they would like to see. In terms of programs that we have delivered and we are delivering, the first thing that we were very happy to be able to create is an Ottawa Sport Council Foundation. That's actually an endowment fund that we're going to be able to use to support community sporting organizations through grants. We will be announcing the first grant opportunities in the next couple of months that will be available to community sporting organizations. The second thing that we are unrolling today is this lunchtime webinar series. We have four events scheduled for the February and March timeframe. The first one is today, the Nutrition for Athletes. The second one is the Hosting of Sporting Events. The third one, the Legal Obligations for Coaches. And the fourth one is Social Media Demystified. Those are happening every other week from now until the beginning of April. And then finally, some of you were able to join us last fall, but we will be running it again this fall. We ran our inaugural Ottawa Sports Summit last November. We had over 100 attendees, and we had some great keynote speakers. We'll be doing the same thing in the November timeframe this year. And what we did last year and we'll be doing again this year is soliciting the sport community in terms of what sorts of topics they would like to hear about and integrating those into the agenda. So now I'd really like to turn things over to our speaker for today, who's Kim Gertler. Kim is a certified sports nutritionist, a coach, and an athlete. And she really loves to work with athletes, both individual ones and teams, to speak to them about healthy eating and how it's going to be able to impact on their performance. As you'll be able to see when Kim begins to speak, she's extraordinarily dynamic. She absolutely loves this topic. She has a lot of passion for it, and I'm sure you're going to be able to learn a lot from what Kim tells you today. So without further ado, I'd like to turn things over to Kim.
Well, thank you very much, Marcy, and thank you to the Ottawa Sport Council for giving me this opportunity, and a big thank you to Deborah as well for making all this happen. I am, as you will find out, very passionate about these three things we're talking about today, which is healthy eating, sports, and kids. And I have lots of information to share with you. I'm very excited about it, so I think we should just get right to it. Nutrition, as Haley Wickenheiser points out here, 50% of it accounts for her performance, 40% is mental training, and the rest is her physical training. But for many different athletes at different levels, healthy eating provides a good foundation for their sporting activities and life in general. We have lots to cover today. We're going to start off by reviewing some of the key concepts of nutrition. We're going to fly through that because I'm assuming that many of you already know a little bit above the who, what, and why of healthy eating. We're going to talk about some myths and misconceptions. We're also going to go over some fueling and recovery points that are important to keep in mind, as well as some timing. We're going to go over some key things to think about when you're on the road during your tournaments. And then we're going to put it all together, and I'm going to share with you a few things that are important to remember when you're talking to your teams, and in particular talking to boys versus talking to girls, because as we know, they communicate very differently. The role of a coach. So why would we talk about nutrition? Well, as you know, some of your coaches, we tend to wear many hats, and our role seems to be never-ending. But I think one of the most important roles we have is that of a role model. And we have an incredible opportunity as coaches to inspire and educate our kids, providing tools and habits that will probably last a lifetime. I know if you remember coaches when you were a child that create an impact on you, a positive impact on you, and that's what we want to do as coaches today. We need to model proper behavior in sport, how to play the game properly, healthy competition, and another aspect of that is proper nutrition. Now, what I hope you walk away with after our hour together is, first off, if you're already talking about food with your team, and I've seen on the polls that some of you already are talking about food, and that's fantastic, I hope that what I'll be sharing with you will simply confirm that you're on the right track and what you're doing is correct, and that you have the confidence to continue talking about healthy eating with your kids. And if this is new to you and you've not done this type of talk with your teams yet, I hope that you walk away with some tips and some key points that you will be able to share with your team, and know that you're sharing this information again with confidence and based on facts. The three pillars of athletic performance. Goodness, diet can have a massive impact on athletic performance. If you're not eating enough quality calories and you're lacking nutrients, that can impair even the most conditioned of athletes. While the right balance of calories and quality nutrients will help any athlete perform at their best, whether they're rec athletes or competitive athletes. Now, one thing that is true at regardless of the level you're playing at is that athletic performance, training, practices, games, they push your body to the edge. You break down your body, and that's a natural activity that happens. And athletic progress can only happen when you give your body the opportunity to recover. And if you don't receive the adequate quality nutrients that your body needs, then your body is not going to recover properly, which will hinder your athletic progress or your kids' athletic progress. So, the macronutrients. This is the foundation of everything when it comes to eating, healthy eating. There are three of them, carbohydrates, proteins, and fats. I'm sure you've heard what all of these things are. I'm going to give you a bit more detail, some simple facts that you can share with your kids in a way that they should be able to understand. And hopefully they will understand how essential they are. All three of these are essential as part of a healthy diet. All carbs are sources of sugar, and sugar is transformed by our bodies into energy. That's a basic way of explaining what carbohydrates do to your body. Carbs are sugar, sugar gets transformed into energy. But there are two different kinds of carbohydrates. One of them is simple on the left side, and the other one is complex, and those examples are on the right side. Now, simple carbohydrates, well, almost all simple carbs are in some way manipulated by man. They are processed food. They're processed very little or a lot, but all of them pretty much have very to little nutrition to them. What simple carbohydrates do for you, though, is they provide you with quick energy. And sometimes that's what you're looking for, but most times the athletes that we are coaching, that's not necessarily the best kind of energy source they need. The issue with simple carbohydrates is they provide a quick release of energy, and then if that energy isn't used right away, then your pancreas kicks in and you get an insulin crash, which causes those energy highs and those energy lows. Now, this can cause chaos for a young athlete, and that's because of that inconsistent supply of energy. Now, complex carbohydrates, on the other hand, are different to simple carbohydrates in that there's a lot more going on. They contain complex molecules that your body needs to transform differently. Now, most complex carbohydrates come to us straight from nature. They're not typically processed in any way or very little, and as the name indicates, they're complex. There's a lot in them. They provide you with all kinds of nutrients and vitamins. But the biggest thing, the most important thing that complex carbohydrates provide you is fiber. I mean, for many reasons, fiber is good for our bodies. One of them being that it keeps you feeling full longer. It also curbs that instant sugar rush that comes along with eating carbs, in that you don't feel that instant rush of energy. It's being slowed down because the body has a lot going on, has a lot to process and a lot to do when you eat complex carbs. Now again, like simple carbs, complex carbs are a sugar, and the body transforms the sugar into energy. Now, again, complex carbs provide you with that steady flow of energy, and that's what our young athletes need in order to perform well. I like painting pictures for the young athletes I talk to because I find I can talk and sometimes they listen, but if I show them a picture of what things do to their body, they tend to understand a little bit better. And when it comes to carbohydrates, I think one of the best ways of showing them the impact of simple versus complex carbs is by showing them an ocean. On the left-hand side, you have the cupcakes, the candies, the pops, the juices, and then at the bottom of that slide, you see that crazy ocean, the waves, the big waves, the crashes, the surges, and that kind of reflects the chaos that happens in their young bodies. They're going to feel that energy spike, that energy crash. That's what it looks like. That's what it feels like. On the other side of the slide, you see that calm, quiet, flowing ocean water, and that's what complex carbohydrates do for our body. They provide us with a steady flow of energy. And that's the carbohydrate of choice for the athletes that we are working with in general. Now, proteins. I think we've all heard of proteins. We hear a lot of talk about protein and what it does for us, and that it's muscle food, and indeed it is. Proteins are essential nutrients, and they have to be part of a healthy diet. And all proteins are made of building blocks called amino acids. Now, when you eat protein, your body breaks down that protein, and it extracts the amino acids. And all cells in our body need amino acids, and every single system in your body needs amino acids in order to perform effectively. Therefore, if we need all these amino acids for all our cells and all our systems, then we need protein in our diets, and especially athletes, because what happens when we work out, when the kids train, practice, have games, sometimes back-to-back, it really breaks down our muscles, our leg muscles, arm muscles, and let's not forget that our heart is a muscle as well. So we will need the protein, the kids need the protein to repair and help rebuild those muscles. And it's important for them to remember this, because what I find fascinating is how carb-focused our diet is these days, and especially foods that are being targeted to young kids and girls. I have found that in working with different teams, boys tend to eat a lot of protein because they're expecting it to build more muscle. And we're going to talk about that a little bit later. Now, one thing that I find fascinating is when you do the math as to how much protein we actually need, because everything out there talks about needing more protein, you need to build muscle, you need to repair muscle.
muscles, you need more protein. Well, when we do the math, in an average individual, in this case, let's take an adult that works out perhaps a few times a week at an average intensity, let's say you weigh 150 pounds, you need about 0.5 grams of protein for every pound. Now that's 75 grams of protein, and the pictures I show on this slide represent what 75 grams of protein looks like. It's not that much. Now, I was really concerned. Both my kids, Alexa is going to be 14 and William is 12. They both play on competitive teams. And I was really worried about how much protein they were eating. I was always telling, you need more protein. Well, once I actually sat down and did the math for them, I realized they were getting more than enough protein in our regular foods that we were eating. For an 80-pound kid, you're looking at 40 grams of protein a day, which is half a chicken breast, one egg, and 1 8-ounce glass of milk. Really. I think we covered that very quickly just with an average healthy diet. Now, this is important to remember as we move forward to this presentation when we'll be talking about supplementation. Now, fats, good fats. Good fats are essential in a healthy diet. And just like carbs, there are different kinds of fats. There's the good fats, and we'll keep it simple, and we'll just call them the bad and ugly fats. Healthy fats, they come from nuts and seeds, avocado, salmon, healthy oils, olive oils, canola oils. And what healthy fats do for you is they provide you brain food and heart food. They help you stay focused. And they also are the second source of energy your body looks for. The first source of energy your body looks for comes from carbohydrates. The second source of energy your body looks for comes from those healthy fats. That's your endurance. That's your staying power. And this idea of low-fat diets being healthy could not be further from the truth. You just need to pick the right fats. Now, the bad fats, what they can do for you is actually not very much. Your body doesn't like processing the bad fat into a source of energy. It's a lot of work for your body to process bad fat into energy. And bad fat is those saturated fat and those trans fats found in deep fried foods, pastries, chips, burgers, the greasy, salty stuff. And what often happens is those bad fats are often accompanied by a bucket load of sugar and salt and other energy-sucking nutrients. Now, the same thing applies to foods that are deemed low-fat, no-fat foods, foods that would normally have fats in them that have been processed and changed to be labeled no-fat or low-fat. Those tend to be accompanied by bucket loads of salt and sugar to make them tastier. So fat is an essential part of a healthy diet. It just needs to be the good fat. So we've gone over all three of the macronutrients. I mean, we did go through that quickly. But bottom line, what your kids need to remember is that protein is good for your muscles. Good fats provide long-lasting energy and that mental focus that you need to stay alert. And complex carbohydrates provide you with lasting energy, and they reduce those peaks and valleys that come by using simple carbohydrates. I think it's time for questions.
Absolutely. That was excellent, Kim, and I think that gives us quite a bit of information as people are processing the difference between the fats and the carbohydrates, and it's interesting to equally see as they're filling out the polls. So one of the questions we have received is, so what about fat-free yogurt?
That is an excellent question. We have fat-free yogurt at home right now. I think that when it comes to milk products, going for the skim milk is a good option because milk is a saturated fat. It's not one of those healthy fats. That being said, I have been reading more about it, and some people are thinking more and more that going for the 2% yogurts and milk can be healthier for different reasons. Now, I haven't fully done my research on that because whenever something new comes up, I tend to sit on it and wait and hear what different parties have to say about it. But my first comment on that is stick to the skim milk versions for now because milk is a saturated fat. But let's see what happens with these new thoughts on the higher fat milk.
No, and that's fair, especially as you've said, like the Greek yogurts and the different types of yogurt coming out. So we have another question as well, and that is, what is the appropriate ratio of carbs to proteins and fats?
Oh, that's an excellent question. If you were to take a plate of food, what you would like to see for your lunch and for your dinner, as an example, would be half your plate would be filled with vegetables. And then one quarter of your plate is your protein, and the other quarter of your plate would be some starch, some potato, sweet potato, brown rice, couscous, quinoa, that kind of stuff. Ideally, you would like 50% of your food from carbs, 25% protein, and 25% healthy fats. But if you want to have a look on your plate, you should see half of your plate filled with vegetables. One quarter is your protein source, whether that's a meat or a legume of some kind, and then 25% would be a starch.
Excellent. Actually, that's good and nice to have a good breakdown. It's interesting, Kim, as we look at the poll results as to your questions about what you think the event concession stands, whether you think they can provide healthy options for athletes, and that over 84% think that that they can. Whether that's really happening or not. Are you seeing that, any trends or any changes happening?
On my side of things, unfortunately, the arenas and the soccer fields and the tournaments we go to, there are not very many healthy options at the canteens, and it's a pretty much fend for yourself, come prepared at the event. So I'd love to hear what some of these canteens are providing that are healthy for the athletes, and I think the Ottawa venues have a lot to learn from that.
No, and I think that's totally valid too, as you say, as they're expanding it. And it's interesting seeing some of the comments, even as to some of the strategies that are being proposed, such as the offering of healthy alternatives in the canteen for halftime breaks, although obviously concerned that nobody would buy it, which is quite key, or suggestions as to planning ahead to bring healthy foods or coordinating team activities, creating team plans is a really good one for planning ahead and practicing healthy eating habits during training. We have one last question before we're going to allow you to keep going on. And one actually refers to, what are options that one can use for nut allergies?
Oh, that's a great question. I know that one go-to snack that we have at home are nuts, and I understand that there's a lot of kids with peanut allergies. Some great options to think about are soy nut butter. Soy nut butter is very healthy and can be used as a replacement to all the other nut butters. Soy nuts, roasted soy nuts, some roasted chickpeas and roasted legumes. In Ottawa, we have the Bean Ladies. And I don't know, I even think they might be across Canada. They have great flavors, reasonably healthy. If you stick to the plain flavors, they're quite good. And they're high in protein, low in fat. They're a great substitute for nuts. Something else is your dairy, your Greek yogurt, your plain yogurt, your cottage cheese. Another great option is hard-boiled eggs. It's maybe thinking a little bit outside of the box when you are dealing with food allergies, but there are definitely some options out there. But I'm a big fan of roasted chickpeas and dried legumes and soy nuts as alternatives.
Excellent. That's really good. And it's actually nice to see that we've even gotten some feedback to add to that from Sean, that if you are trying to avoid soy, as soy is very unhealthy, especially for those with hypothyroidism or any autoimmune conditions, what should be considered? So comments on that, Kim?
I would be going for some of the dairy products, some hard-boiled eggs, and some roasted legumes, some chickpeas. Like I said, the Bean Ladies here in Ottawa provide different roasted beans that are quite good, not necessarily soy-based. They're more chickpea-based.
And so since soy is a more major allergen, what can be done if soy nut butter is exposed?
If soy nut butter is exposed...
Yeah, I'm just reading sort of Pauline's comment here. Since soy is a major allergen, what can be done if soy nut butter is exposed? So I'm guessing if the client's, you know, if the child is exposed to soy nut butter.
Oh, I would have to follow their personal allergy protocols. Some kids, I know some of the nut allergies, we have a nut allergy on the team and we can't have no nuts as part of our snacks in the change rooms. Or when we're on tournament, we try to be very careful of that. So if there is a soy nut allergy involved on a team, perhaps it's to talk to the team members and make sure that there are no soy products around, available, or close to that child.
Actually, and that's a good point, because you're right. There's a lot of dressing rooms right now that people are trying to be sensitive and trying to make those obviously food-free or sensitive to a lot of different allergens. So there's some great questions, great comments, and we'll keep bringing them up and we'll keep sharing them with everyone. But at this point, Kim, actually, I'm going to pass it back to you to let you keep yourself moving along, and we'll ask more questions at the next intermission.
That sounds great. All right, three every three. That's a general rule of thumb to follow. Three every three, meaning eating every 3 hours from all three food groups at a minimum. And eating all three food groups, meaning carbs, proteins, and fat, because as we've just found out, they're all essential part of a healthy diet. Now, this might come across as a simple concept, but sometimes people on our team need to have specific examples. Kids need examples, and parents need help in planning. And a good place to start would be breakfast, because breakfast tends to be one of those foods that is very carb focused. And a lot of our kids tend to focus on carbs for their breakfast. Sometimes, I know some of the kids, the sports teams I've worked with, it was not uncommon for them to start their day with pancakes and syrups and plain cereal with milk and plain oatmeal with sugar and raisins or a bagel with Nutella on it. And a lot of those breakfasts are accompanied by a glass of orange juice. Now, when kids show up having eaten these kinds of breakfast, or even worse, not eaten at all, it's kind of a crapshoot what you end up getting with regards to energy and attitude. They may start up all pumped and full of energy, borderline hyper in some cases. Then as the game or the practice continues, they're going to start to run out of steam, they're going to be crabby, they'll be unfocused, and they will underperform. And it's pretty clear to see why if all they've had are carbohydrates. There's no staying energy in their body. Now, one of the most important habits that you can instill in your kids is to take the time to have a good, healthy breakfast, or at least, a very least, have a healthy snack en route to the game or to the event. Now, what makes a great breakfast great? Well, it has all three macronutrients. And I understand that it's not always easy to have eggs and whole grain toast and fruit in the morning before you leave, but it's pretty simple to throw something healthy together, such as a whole wheat wrap with nut butter, soy butter, and a banana. Roll it up. The kids love that. Or having a yogurt parfait. You take a mason jar or a thermos, put some yogurt, alternate some berries with some granola, and you've got a great breakfast on the road, a great snack on the road before you get to your sporting event. Now, as in every house, I think some mornings chaos strikes, and even getting a snack for the road is virtually impossible because people aren't moving quickly, or we simply aren't prepared with the fridge stocks with food to go. So a couple of the great stops you can do is at Tim Hortons or McDonald's, and I'm not saying that a store-bought breakfast would replace a home-cooked breakfast, but as I said, chaos can sometimes strike, and a good option, store-bought option out there would be the Egg McMuffin type sandwiches, the whole wheat English muffin, the egg, the cheese. I always recommend to skip the meat because the meat that they provide is, there's no health benefit to it whatsoever, and it tends to be packed with sodium. So take the meat out of there, stick to the cheese, the egg, and the whole wheat bread product, and you've got a pretty decent snack for your kids to eat before they get to whatever sporting event they're going to. I would stay clear of store-bought smoothies. They say they're healthy, but they're nothing more than liquid sugar in a blender. Now, some common myths and misconceptions. Post-game snacks, chocolate milk, Gatorade, protein powder supplementation. Well, let's get down to the bottom of these things, and let's see where we go with this. So post-game snacks. Is a snack required after your practice game for soccer, hockey, or ringette? Well, my first answer to that is no. Why associate sport with snacking? Ideally, I think we all want the kids to love the game for the sake of loving the game, not because there's a cooler waiting for them at the end of the field with popsicles, or because there's a hot chocolate waiting for them at the end of the game. And as a coach, I think we're expected to set the tone of what is expected within our team, and one of those expectations is team nutrition. A discussion with the parents and the kids as to when a post-game snack is required is important. And it's nice to talk to the kids about this kind of stuff, but it's also very important to talk to the parents because the parents make the purchasing decisions. Now, is a snack required? Well, you have to ask yourself a few questions. Has the team worked at high intensity for more than 90 minutes? If the answer is no, then a recovery snack is perhaps not required. And I understand that some parents, and especially for the younger teams, like the Timbits and the young kids playing soccer, some parents may feel that a snack should be a part of the fun and the social aspect of the game, and I'm all for that. Let's just make sure it's fruit, because really anything more than a piece of fruit after that kind of a game is overkill and not needed. And again, I really want to help children and kids make that connection between working out, being part of a team and sport for the love of it, not because of the snacks that come after it. But one thing that all kids need before, during, and after is water. Now, chocolate milk, is it truly the perfect recovery drink? This was in the news, I think, last year, the year before. There was no end to how awesome chocolate milk was for us, and everybody was on the chocolate milk bandwagon. Well, what it does have is it does indeed have that perfect ratio for recovery, which is 4 parts carbs for every gram of protein, and that's fine, but every small carton of milk, that 250 mils of milk, the small one, has 26 grams of sugar, or 6.5 teaspoons of sugar. That's equivalent to over 6 Oreo cookies. So, Is chocolate milk necessary? Not for the level of intensity our kids are playing at. I think there's a time and a place for that kind of recovery drink, but as a general rule, the sugar in the chocolate milk kind of outweighed the benefits of it. Now, you may be wondering about juices. Well, juices are even worse. The good thing about chocolate milk, at least, is it does have some fats and it does have some proteins. But juice is nothing more than liquid sugar. I mean, apple juice, ounce for ounce, has more sugar than Coke. And orange juice is not much better. And the examples I'm showing you on this slide is for 1 cup of juice, right? 1 cup. Most of the bottles you buy at the store are just under 500 mils. So your bottle of apple juice would have almost 50 grams of sugar of that instant energy. And if you're not using up that energy right away, it's going to cause chaos in your child's body. And again, there's a time and a place for that simple carbohydrate, for that rush of energy, but as a general rule, it's not something our young athletes need. What they do need is water. There's no other perfect recovery drink than water. They need to drink water before their event, they need to drink water during their event, and they need to drink water after their event. Now, Gatorade. Well, I'm not sure if many of you watched the World Juniors hockey games. I think it was after Christmas. But I think every second shot of somebody in the player's box was holding a bottle of Gatorade. Just about every commercial was the fuel of God, and when your heart races, the clock has no chance, and win from within, and it was all Gatorade or chocolate milk, and I was sitting on my couch just cringing, thinking these poor children are going to think this is what they need to be these kinds of players, and that's not the case. They're not playing anywhere near at the same intensity these players, that the junior world players, were playing at. Now, Gatorade is sold to us as an electrolyte replacement drink, and electrolytes are very important. Electrolytes are essential nutrients that help maintain fluid balance. They also are responsible for muscle contractions and neural activity. Now, electrolyte imbalance occurs when you lose an excessive amount of body fluids through sweat. An excessive amount of body fluids. Losing an excessive amount of electrolytes doesn't happen with each workout, with each practice or game. And in order to lose an excessive amount of electrolytes, you should be sweating profusely. And chances are you've been working out hard, the kids have been playing hard for well over an hour, closer to 90 minutes. Now, that does happen sometimes. I know in Ottawa, when the kids are playing soccer, it's 30 plus degrees, it's hot, it's humid, they are sweating, they're working hard. And you know what, at that point, perhaps an electrolyte replacement is required. But let's find out what Gatorade offers us. So I'm not sure if you can read the ingredients on that slide, but I'm just going to go through it quickly. So Gatorade has water and sugar, dextrose, which is a form of sugar from starch, which your body absorbs quickly, which is a great source of instant energy, which some athlete needs at some point during their competition. It also has salt, which is one of those electrolytes. It also has, after that, a bunch of preservatives, flavor enhancers, and citric acid, which provides that tangy flavor in the drink. So basically, it's water, sugar, and salt, and preservatives. Now, I don't know if you can notice what I have circled on that slide, but the bottle of Gatorade also comes with 42 grams of sugar. Now, 42 grams of sugar is just over 10 teaspoons of sugar, and that, of course, translates to just over 10 Oreos of sugar. You would need to eat 10 Oreo cookies to get the equivalent amount of sugar. So is Gatorade really necessary? I don't think so. What might be some alternatives? Well, when the kids are out playing in the heat for extended periods of time, or maybe in the rink for extended periods of time, and they're really working hard, they're tired, perhaps they could use some electrolytes. And the essential nutrients that we're looking for are potassium, sodium, calcium, and magnesium. Those are the four main ones. But interestingly enough, if any of you have participated in road races, triathlon, marathons, half marathons, 10Ks, what you will find most of the time at that recovery tent are bananas. And you'll also find perhaps some whole wheat bagels. And those have a lot of those elements that you're looking for at replacing the potassium, the sodium, the calcium, and the magnesium. If you're looking for something liquid and not necessarily food-based, then one product that I'm a big fan of is Noon. And it comes in many different flavors. And it has all the electrolytes that need to be replaced, all eight of them. And it also comes in a tablet format. You can split it in half. The only thing I'm not a big fan of is it does come with, or it is made with an artificial sweetener called sorbitol. But I, for the once in a while times that the kids use this electrolyte replacement, I'm fine with that. I'd rather they have that than they have the 42 grams of sugar and the chemicals that comes in the Gatorade bottles. Now, again, an electrolyte replacement is only required when the kids have been sweating a lot, have been working hard, perhaps a back-to-back event in warm settings, but they're certainly not for every game or every practice. Supplementation. Now, I was asked a couple of weeks ago by a mom of a AAA hockey player. He's 16, and she came across a bucket or jar of mutant powder in his room, and when the conversation started, one of the guys on the team had started taking it, and they all thought it was a good idea to start take, and they were taking it without any type of guidance from coaches or anybody. And what's a little bit scary of this kind of stuff is it is readily available, and many of them come from with serious warnings. And when you've got kids coaching kids on nutrition supplementation, that always raises red flags. In the case of this mutant powder, there was a warning at the back of it that said use for 8 weeks and then wean yourself off and be off of it for 4 weeks. And taking the mutant powder could affect certain medications. So any type of supplementation like that needs to be done under the advice of a doctor or a team doctor or somebody on a team that knows what they're talking about. And it shouldn't be done just by 16-year-olds that think this is a good idea. I'm not saying that there's not a time and a place for that kind of stuff, but for the average athlete on a regular sports team, that type of supplementation is perhaps not necessary. So what about protein powders? Because there's a lot of talk out there about protein powders and muscle milk and extra protein and smoothies and that kind of stuff. And that can come in very handy because we've just talked about the fact that our bodies need proteins and amino acids to rebuild and make stronger muscles, and that is definitely the case. But we need to ask ourselves, do the kids need that much more protein? Because as we also found out, we don't need that much protein as an average athlete, and our diet, a healthy diet, can cover most of those needs. And the other question is we need to ask ourselves is, do we want our kids to be used to eating from powders or eating real foods? And I always go for the real foods. Now, there is a time and a place for protein powder because it is convenient. A scoop in a morning smoothie as the kids are rushing out the door, they've got lots of sports going on, have had lots of sports going on. Hey, why not? That's a great idea. But keep in mind that protein powder are processed foods. And just because the scoop says, or the back of the bottle says there's 26 grams of protein per each scoop, doesn't necessarily mean your body will absorb all of those 26 grams. And again, you want to get the kids used to eating real foods and really finding out what your protein requirements really are. Because extra protein beyond what is required is simply extra calories that is perhaps not required. Oh, time for more questions.
Actually, that's really interesting. And Kim, I love the comparison of the Oreo cookie comparison, the 6 Oreo cookies for chocolate milk, the 10 Oreo cookies for Gatorade. Ever so valid, because for sure we heard everyone talking about, well, instead of Gatorade, let's use chocolate milk. So very good. One of the questions that also came up was, what about the 100% coconut water?
Oh, interesting question. I had that question a while ago as well. Coconut water is being deemed as a great after-sport drink, and absolutely it is. But you have to be careful as the kind of coconut water you choose, because some of them are no different than souped up juices. Look at the ingredients at the back. If you've got pure coconut water, then it might be a great addition to a busy athlete, or to help supplement a busy athlete. But really, it can be no more than just a fancy juice with lots of sugar added to it.
Well, that's interesting, because you hear about, obviously, coconut water is everywhere, and you equally hear about Aloha water that's coming out. Just kind of on that, so I guess, what about if it's 100% pure coconut water with no extra sugar added?
If there's no extra sugar added, then it can be a great addition to your diet, absolutely.
Perfect. So what do you suggest to put in a smoothie?
Oh, well, our regular smoothie at home these days is it's a couple of big handfuls of spinach, some pineapple, some English cucumber, and some berries and some water. We blend that up, and to that we'll add some ground up flax seeds or some chia seeds or some of our homemade granola, and it's absolutely fantastic. Another great recipe for smoothie is using some skim milk yogurt with the berries and some oranges and adding a bit of spinach to it. The spinach will only change the color. It adds a ton of nutrition, and it doesn't really change the taste of it. And anytime you can sneak extra veggies into our diet, and especially our kids' diet, then we're getting bonus points all around.
So interesting that you talk about veggies, because one of the other questions here is, what is your impression of greens powder?
You know what? There are different types of green powders, and some of them are excellent. I mean, I think it's the one from Progressive that is excellent. There's all good things in it, and it's a nice way to add, especially if you have kids that perhaps don't like eating their vegetables very much. I mean, I would encourage parents and coaches out there to encourage kids to eat vegetables, but if this is the only way to sneak them in, then adding a spoonful of that into your smoothie in the morning certainly will not hurt them, and it will only benefit them. So yes, greens is a great way to add those extra nutrients to a diet, perhaps for a picky eater.
Ah, excellent. Good. Any thoughts on hemp?
Oh, I love hemp. Hemp hearts. Add them to everything. They're great fat. They're great. They add some protein, great fiber. You can't go wrong by adding a few tablespoons of hemp hearts to your breakfast, to your salads, to your smoothies. Yes, absolutely.
I'm going to read this one here because it's a really interesting comment to get your thoughts on. So from James, it's coming in about protein powder supplements. Some of our elite boxers were taking BCAAs not knowing what it does for them. After a visit to the nutritionist, we found out that there were, in fact, illegal substances in it and that they can be quite dangerous. Any comments on that?
Yes, well, that BCAA was that mutant powder that 16-year-old AAA hockey boy was taking. And the small warnings at the back were shocking. And yes, any type of supplementation beyond and like above and beyond just a simple protein powder really needs to be examined closely by somebody in the know, and like a medical doctor or a team doctor or a sports nutritionist that can interpret what those ingredients are. But yes, the BCAAs, I mean, you got to be really careful what you're getting. And the scary thing is kids can get this off the internet. So parents beware and coaches beware. If you have a high level, older team, you have to talk to the kids about what they could be getting into and how dangerous this stuff can really be. So great point, James. Thank you.
Yeah, no, that's very valid, and especially when, you know, exposed, and it's peer pressure that could be pulling them into it, which is key. Sort of one of those questions along when we're adding scoops of protein or something, there's the question that says, wouldn't it be better to add a scoop of powdered milk into the smoothie as opposed to protein for young athletes?
Absolutely, or even just adding the yogurt itself to the smoothie, right? Whenever you add a protein powder, like I think the average amount of protein that is one of those powders is about 26 grams, and when we look at a child that needs about 40 grams of protein a day, that's more than half their protein requirement covered with one shake. Now, you really need to think about if that's really needed. Now, if it is needed, then yes, adding some whey powder, it won't hurt, certainly. I'm a big fan of using real foods, though, so using the Greek yogurts or plain yogurts or supplementing with seeds and nuts and that kind of stuff.
Cool. And so last question before we move on, and that's dealing with the real foods. So what about, and this is dealing with orange juice from concentrate, when you see the frozen tins and it looks like it's actually just frozen pulp. How can that actually be so bad when you're referring to sugar being sugar?
Well, you know what? That is an excellent question because I get asked this by parents when I do sports talks to their teams on a regular basis, and it's an excellent question because it's from fruit, but sugar is sugar is sugar. It's processed in your body no differently than if it came from candy. And the interesting thing is when you're drinking a glass of juice, you have to think about how many pieces of fruit was required to make that juice. As an example, for an average size glass of juice, you'd be looking at 3 or 4 oranges, maybe even 5 oranges or 5 apples, and at no point would you eat that many oranges in one sitting, but chances are you don't. So you are getting a lot of sugar from that one glass of juice, and you're much better off getting eating the fruit itself. That way you get the fiber and all those fresh nutrients from the fruit. I would stay away from juices. I mean, juices are delicious, but juices are a treat, and they need to be seen as a treat and not as an everyday part of a meal.
Excellent advice and ever so true. Okay, Kim, so at this point, I'm going to give it back to you and let you bring in this final section.
Sounds good. Thank you. And great questions, by the way. Thank you for all those questions. All right, moving on. Fueling, recovery, and timing. Now, this applies to you and your team, right? What and how much you eat before exercise does matter for your performance, and it depends on the intensity and duration of your exercise. Now, as an adult, before you reach for a snack, you need to ask yourself, am I hungry? When was the last time I ate? How long will I be exercising for? When's my next workout? Well, the same type of questions need to be asked of the kids. Now, the 3 every 3 rule I talked about previously states that you need to eat at least every 3 hours from all 3 food groups. So if you've not eaten within 3 hours, then yes, a snack is very important, especially if you're heading out to a sporting event. Now, why does this matter to you as a coach? Well, you want a team that shows up ready in every way, and sometimes all that's needed is a small snack to get the team back on track before the practice or the game to ensure the kids are ready. Now, this could be as simple as reminding your team before the next practice to come prepared, and prepared means fueled up. Now, the goals of eating before exercise are simple. It's so the kids don't show up starving where all they can think about is food. You want all eyes on you and all ears on you, and you want them to be topped up with their energy. When we eat carbohydrates, it's sugar. Sugar transforms to energy in our body. What we don't use gets stored into our muscles and our liver as glycogen. So you want those glycogen stores topped up. Now, pre-game snack, very important. Post-game snack, well, it depends on the energy output, and we're going to talk about that in a few moments. And we're also going to talk about what some of those snacks should look like. So pre-sport fueling. Ideally, you want to have a full meal at least 2 to 3 hours before. 2 hours is cutting close to the event. So you want to look at about 2.5 to 3 hours before. And I really like this slide because it gives you a good idea of portion sizes. Now, keeping in mind that an adult hand and your kid's hands are different sizes. So when you're looking at the size of protein, it should be about the size of your hand, your palm, and then a good handful of vegetables, a smaller handful of carbs, and about the equivalent of a thumb size of good healthy fats. Now, and again, the visual I shared before of your plate being mostly vegetables with a little bit of meat and a little bit of starch, that same principle applies here. You want to be vegetable heavy, complex carbohydrate heavy, especially before a sporting event. And again, cutting it close in 2 hours, you might be looking at taking a good snack instead of a meal. So 60 minutes to 30 minutes before a sporting event, whether it's a practice or a game, you're looking for smaller things, things that are easier to digest because your body will be very busy practicing its sport, right? So you want to make something or take something that is easy to digest, that's easy and quick, and focusing on good quality carbohydrates, whole grains, fruit, vegetables with some protein and some healthy fats that are easy to digest. A big go-to thing, again, I'm using a lot of nut butters, and I'm aware there's a lot of nut allergies out there, but nut butter is pretty awesome with bananas and one slice of toast or half a bagel. More than that, and it's too much. A piece of fruit with the cheese string is even a great pregame snack. Some avocado on whole wheat cracker is also a great snack. And a little bit of yogurt, a plain yogurt with a little bit of fruit or a bit of granola is also a great choice. And a bit of cream cheese with some crackers can also be an option for you, or a handful of nuts. Another go-to snack that I know my kids fall back on is plain cereal with skim milk. And I talk about plain cereal because so many of them, oh my gosh, they're full of fiber, they're full of protein, they're full of B6 and folate and everything else, but they're also full of crap. So I would stick to simple cereals. Like, I mean, I know Cheerios doesn't have very much to it, but if you're looking for a complex carb, that's what you're going to get out of a bowl of Cheerios or a bowl of bran flakes. And before an event, that's really what you're looking for. Now, recovery. Well, first things first, you need water. The kids need water. Really, that's all they really need. They need water before the event. They need water during the event. They need water after their event. One thing that I didn't mention in the pregame meal and snack is one thing I tell my teams all the time is when you get to the venue, you need to go pee. If you don't need to go pee, you haven't drank enough water on your way to the arena or on your way to the field. So that's one thing to keep in mind. So water is the first thing to reach for. And then if it's necessary, if, again, a post-game snack, post-practice snack is not always required depending on the intensity and what's happening afterwards. But if a recovery snack is required, you start with the water and then you go for some simple snacks. And you'll notice that the suggestions I'm showing you on the slides are very similar to the pre-game snack because they include the same things, a good quality complex carb with a little bit of protein and a little bit of fat. The carbohydrates replenish your energy stores, the proteins help rebuild the muscles, and the fat, well, it's just a good thing to have in your diet to help with that sustained energy as well as that feeling of fullness. Now, one thing that can come in quite handy, and I'm not a fan of sweetened yogurt by any stretch of the imagination, but yogurt tubes can come in handy once in a while. They provide you that perfect 4-to-1 ratio that the chocolate milk gives you, but with less of that sugar. So yogurt tubes are a good option for that protein-carb ratio. And to be effective, a post-game snack, if you are to have one and you don't want the kids to hit the wall, you should have it within an hour, even sooner than that after your event. On the road with your team. Oh my goodness, we love tournaments. I love tournaments. The girls love tournaments. I coach ringette teams. And I mean, we're in big tournament season right now. We're heading to provincials in a few weeks. And the big thing is, where am I going? What am I doing? What am I eating? Oh, it's nonstop. Well, what you need to have is you need to have a really good team manager. That's the first thing your team needs to have if you plan to be on the road very much. You need to find out what the best hotels are, which offers the best breakfast. And if they don't offer a good breakfast, then come prepared. Make sure that there are the rooms have fridges and microwaves so you can have a yogurt and granola or steel-cut oats or something to heat up and ready to go for your kids. The other thing, you need to think outside of the box when it comes to your team meals. You don't always have to go to a restaurant. You can plan a potluck dinner at the hotel. Oftentimes, hotels will let you use their conference room facilities free of charge or the breakfast rooms free of charge. So again, having a good team manager makes a big difference. And providing a detailed schedule. When are they supposed to arrive where? What time are the games? What time are the meals? When is a snack needed? And what should that snack look like? Because in order to be at their best, most kids need to know that there is a plan and they're being taken care of. And actually, to be very honest, I think most adults and parents like this too. That way there are no questions. Everybody knows what the plan is. And a written out schedule makes it easier for everybody. And again, having a schedule will depend on the type of team you have. Some teams are out there for fun, but some teams are out there to perform. And providing teams with a detailed schedule with what will be had for lunch and dinner and providing snacks after the games, because there are no fridges to go back to if you're going from arena to arena or field to field. It just takes a bit of planning, and again, I know our team manager is worth her weight and goal in her organizational skills and her hotel finding abilities. Oh, talking to your team. Talking to your team about food is very important as we're finding out. But talking to a girl team or talking to a boy team, well, it's different. They have different issues. When it comes to girls in sports, the way I talk to the girls is they're eating to power their body. They're eating to help their body get stronger, to help their body recover from the hard practices and the hard games we've had. They're eating so they can perform at a competitive level so that they can be strong, fierce, and awesome. Food is a positive thing. Protein, carbs, and fat, healthy fat, are good for you. When it comes to girls and sports, especially at the competitive level, you need to be aware of some of the eating disorders out there. A few years ago on one of the soccer teams, we had one of our girls that's a super athlete. She was top of the team, high achiever at school, all-around superstar, personality and everything, and she developed anorexia, and we all noticed something was a little off. Very tired, shaking all the time, very moody. Anyways, she ended up having to be hospitalized, which was very sad. She's now healthy again, which is wonderful, and back playing. But when it comes to girls, food is a good thing. Fat is healthy, and we need to eat from all food groups. And again, it's about creating a body or building a body that is strong to be able to compete at the level that they want to compete. And there's so much pressure on girls to have a certain look, and many athletic girls don't have that look, and that's fine because they're powerful. Now, when it comes to boys and young athletes, well, it's kind of the same message, just said a little bit differently. They're also eating to be powerful and strong and awesome and be at their best. But we need to make sure they eat from all food groups, not just proteins. When I look at what my son eats and what my daughter eats, oh my goodness, sometimes it's shocking. I think William would eat the entire cow if he could. But you need to talk to them about eating real food. And if there is any concern or suggestion of supplementation, they need to talk to a health professional. And that needs to be followed seriously by somebody, an adult on the team or a doctor that's close to the team. And when you're dealing with younger athletes, like young kids, Timbits, and small boys or girls playing sports for the first time, it's all about establishing healthy eating habits that are going to last a lifetime and associating sport for the love of the game, not just about the snacks. But it comes down to eating to be powerful, to be strong, and to be awesome, and to give the body what it needs in order to be at its best. Now, I've been talking a lot about healthy eating, healthy food, healthy this, healthy that, making the right choices. I haven't once mentioned junk food and chocolate-covered jujubes and chocolates and burgers and fries, and I'm not trying to leave it out. I think when we're talking to our teams, it's not about eliminating junk food. It's about eating well most of the time, indulging at the right time, and most importantly, having the kids realize they need to know the difference. Going to a game is not when you want to eat a burger and a handful of jujubes. And after a game, that food perhaps might not be the best choice. That maybe is something you have a couple of hours after once you've had a healthy snack. With the teams I'm involved with, the girls know to pay particular attention to what they eat up leading to tournaments and weekends where we have a lot of ice time. But they know that when we're on a road trip, like when we're driving back on the 401, there's a Bulk Barn right in Kingston off the highway, and that's one of the first stops we make after they've had a healthy snack in the car on the drive from the arena on our way back home, because there are chocolate-covered jujubes at the Bulk Barn, and that's one treat we all love. So it's talking to your teams about when healthy eating is important, and snacking is absolutely a part of life. It's delicious. And it's knowing to make the right choice at the right time. And another thing I talk to the kids about is the 80-20 rule. Eating well 80% of the time and allowing yourself the opportunity to indulge the other 20. Because life is too short not to have chocolate cake and cupcakes. It's just a question of knowing when to be eating these chocolate cupcakes and all that stuff. The other thing is kids will often listen better when any message comes from someone other than mom or dad, especially when you're dealing with preteens or teens. Mom and dads, well, I certainly don't know very much in my house as far as my kids are concerned. So sometimes the message is better heard from a coach. I know on some of the teams I've talked to, they'll say things like, well, Coach Kim says I should have eggs for breakfast, despite the fact the parent has been saying that they should have eggs for breakfast anyways. Just because somebody else has told them, then they will listen better. The other thing is kids will also do what they see, not necessarily what they are told, which means you also need to walk that talk. You need to set the example. And as coaches, as I mentioned at the beginning, we have such an incredible opportunity to make a difference in these kids' lives on so many different levels. Now, as we've just talked about, diet will affect athletic performance. And actually, healthy eating will affect your everyday life. Healthy eating means eating well. It also means knowing when to indulge and knowing the difference between when those times are. Now, that's all I have for you today. I hope that you've learned a few things today that you'll be able to carry back to your team. I hope that you feel confident and ready to talk about healthy eating and nutrition with your team. So thank you very much for joining us today. And again, thank you to Marcy and Deborah for allowing me this incredible opportunity. And if you have some questions, I think we might have a few more minutes.
Kim, that was excellent. And I think not only in your whole dialogue, but some of the exchange of people going back and forth, in particular, as you were referring to, you know, the importance of watching out for feeding the girls. And as, you know, one of our colleagues just pointed out as well, that, you know, eating disorders aren't just in girls, that they are in boys too. So we have to be very careful and sensitive for everybody. I also love your 80-20 rule. So obviously it's great to know if you're eating, you know, 80% of the time healthy, then 20% of the time we can look forward as to having some fun. So good to know we can source the chocolate covered jujubes at Bulk Barn. There was a question as well, just asking about the cereal bars and, you know, whether you see that as being a possible snack or something else to be bringing into the field.
Oh, well, granola bars, cereal bars, you know, yes and no. It depends on the type. Many of them are no more than a cookie with flaxseed or quinoa on them. I mean, it's about reading the labels, seeing what they're made of. What are the first three ingredients of that bar? If the first three ingredients are whole grains and great food, healthy food that you recognize, then perhaps they're a good choice. Watch the sugar content as well as the sodium content and the fat content. Some of the go-to bars that we use are the Lara bars. But again, a Lara bar has a lot of sugar in it. It's good sugar. It comes from dates. Or I shouldn't say good sugar. It's a natural sugar. It's not added sugar. But half a Lara bar is all kids really need, or adults really need, as a snack with a piece of fruit or something of the sort. So cereal bars, I would say be leery. Very few of them are healthy. Read the labels. If the first three ingredients you recognize as whole grains and good foods, then they might be a good choice. Check the sugar content, but nothing beats a piece of fruit, a slice of cheese, piece of fruit, handful of nuts, that kind of stuff.
Very good. So we've got actually a couple of questions that are related, and they're dealing with parents. And it's more or less the concept of how do you get the parents on board, whether it's, you know, understanding this is the process, or, you know, making sure that they're not basing it on, you know, mommy bloggers, but that they're actually referring to valid science or the knowledge that you're sharing. So what's your comments on parents?
Oh, you know, you have to be very careful, because criticizing how children eat, some people take it very personally. It can be taken as offensive. You have to talk about food very gently, and it's about providing them with the right information and providing them with options, not just saying they need to eat this, this, and this, but they need to eat this from these kinds of foods, giving them some recipes and providing them with some healthy options and why that's important to them. Going to some great websites. There's some great websites out there that provide lots of nutrition information that are based on science, great recipes out there that are all healthy. And when you give the parents the tools that they need, sometimes they're more open to make some changes to their diets. And also, if the message comes from the kids, oftentimes, I know that I do a lot of work with the Edelweiss ski team here in Ottawa, and one of the moms came to me after the second presentation I did this winter and said, her child brought to her the granola bar, she said, and said, Mom, look at this. This has more sugar than, you know, three Oreo cookies. And the dialogue started that way for them. So when the kids point out that they need to be eating differently, then the message gets driven home in a different way. But when you're talking with parents, you have to be careful as to the tone you use and that you're sharing information, not telling them what to do.
Very valid when dealing directly with kids. So at this point, I think we're going to be bringing Marcy back in to wrap it up. That is the opportunity because this has been very, very helpful. And I know that we're going to be sharing that back with the registrants, as well as it's going to be available up on the website, both at the Ottawa Sport Council and at CERC. That we can move it along. So I think at this point, we're actually going to bring Marcy on. And Marcy, if you want to do the final wrap-up, it's over to you.
Thanks so much, Deborah. And Kim, thanks very much as well. I hope everybody got as much out of that presentation as I did. I've had the opportunity to hear Kim speak a number of times, both individually and with teams. And she has a profound effect on people in terms of, as I said, her passion for the topic and just the educational value that she brings to the table. As Deborah mentioned, we will be posting this webinar on our website. We really encourage you to share the link with other people. I've had actually a couple of coordinators for different organizations call me to find out where their coaches will be able to access it. So it will be available both on our website and on the CERC website, hopefully within a week. And then our next webinar will be in 2 weeks' time. We'll be having Jason Robinson from the Sport Law Group join us to be talking about bidding and hosting sport events. This is an area that there definitely is also a lot of confusion about. Can a small little community sport organization host a sporting event, and why would they care? And one of the biggest reasons you would want to do it is to showcase your sport. Another really big reason is the financial opportunities that come with hosting a sporting organization and the opportunity to provide some funding for your organization. So I strongly encourage you, if you're able to join us in 2 weeks' time for that webinar. And on that, I'd just like to thank Deborah and Kim once again. And if you do have any questions, please get in touch. Thanks so much.
Excellent. Thanks, everybody. And we look forward to seeing you next time. Take care.